Hello and welcome to this brand new episode of Fargonauts. I'm here with my brochi guys, my boys.
There's some brochi boys.
These boys be brochi.
So
these boys be brochi.
The time has come, my brochi boys, to talk about other things.
Yes.
We are doing the return of Twin Peaks.
Yeah.
And, yeah, they, watching the first two seasons, it kind of put us in a, you know, we started that when, like early October or something like that?
Damn.
When it was like prime Twin Peaks.
Prime Peak.
Like, yep. It was that season of like dreary, you know, cold and kind of spooky.
Angelo Badalamenti seasons.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
Right at the beginning of that October month.
I do want to mention real quick, during our watch of Twin Peaks, we kind of deviated and, you know, we, at the end of season one, I think we watched like Blue Velvet or something like that.
Yeah.
And then we watched, you know, Fire Walk With Me after season two. That's a no-brainer. But I actually watched another thing with David Lynch directing and Everett McGill in it and Sissy Spacek.
Chain Toad Conquest?
No. That was our palate cleanser. But I'm just going to mention this because it was a David Lynch Disney movie.
Oh, really?
You might have not have known that David Lynch made a Disney movie.
Maybe.
I didn't. It depends. Is it a Disney movie or is it a movie that was put out by Disney?
It has Disney on the front. It's produced by Disney. It's definitely it's on Disney's, you know, streaming service. But it's called The Straight Story. And it has Angelo Badalamenti doing his amazing music.
What?
Yeah. It's a very
1999.
It's a very well put together, strange still kind of movie. It's kind of contemplative and a meditation of this guy as a farmer finds out his brother Harry Dean Stanton had a stroke and he can't drive. This old farmer, he has a really bad back, he never really learned to drive, but he drives a riding lawnmower.
Yep.
So he drives this lawnmower to his brother's place, like in Wisconsin or something like that, something like very far away from where he actually lives, and it takes him like, I don't know, a month or two to get there riding a lawnmower. And he kind of just stops and camps. It's a very like well shot, and like it gives that landscape, like that open road kind of vibe to it. It's really relaxing to watch. It's very meditative and very like slow, but like you appreciate that this guy's like in his later stages of life, and he kind of comes across to younger people throughout his journey, and he kind of tells them like his woes and what it's like growing old and things like that. And that's kind of put me in another mindset when we're going into the return, because it is 25 years later, right? It's like our characters are older and they're gonna look a lot older from when we last saw them. It's gonna be pretty jarring.
Chris Farley brothers are in that movie, dude.
That's right. Yep, the Farley brothers are in it, and they Jim, scenes together.
Jim Belushi's brother's in this.
That's right. Yeah. John.
You mean John Belushi's brother?
Yeah.
Jim. Yes, that is what I mean. You're correct.
Unless John Belushi's in this show.
So I'll just say, go check that movie out. Go check out The Straight Story. It's based on a true story. I sat through it. I was, you know, pleasantly surprised. I knew kind of what I was getting in for, and David Lynch has talked about it in the past being like it's his most experimental film. And that's kind of funny coming from him, like, after watching like Eraserhead and things like that. His most experimental.
No, that was straight shooting, bro.
Yeah, that's like that's just right off the cuff. I knew exactly what I was doing.
Zero experimentation.
The thing to note too with this series, how just comfy we were with like OG Peaks. I don't know that there's anything comfy about the return.
There's some Dougie stuff that I would say.
Dougie,
comfy, but like
Dougie is my ultimate comfort. But still,
even then, it's like it's not it's the like same. a
It's more unnerving, yeah. I think.
Well, it's like it's the kind of comfort unnerving that you might find from a different fucking show. So it's just like, it feels so separate.
It does. It doesn't. It's its own thing.
Well, we're gonna get into it. I'm so excited. So here we are.
So excited.
We're gonna watch The Return, the first episode.
Twin Peaks: The Return.
Twin Returns of Peaks.
So it begins.
Hell yeah.
Get used to this shit.
Hell yeah, bro.
What a great first episode, right, guys? We're back. Oh, we're back in it.
We are back in it. There's no arguing that.
So what do we all think of this first episode? Did it feel like Twin Peaks?
Felt like the return.
It felt like the return.
There's moments of Peaks. There's definitely moments of Peaks. You know,
it shone through. You had your Ben Horn. You had your Lucy and Andy and Hawk and Jacoby. A few moments of it feeling maybe a little bit like picking back up with these old characters. But for the most part, like, there's some stuff going on where it's just a different show altogether.
Yeah, there was never really like this idea of these experiments happening from this eccentric, no-named billionaire from the previous show or the previous, you know, things. But there were elements like this moment where this guy's just watching this box, right? We got some of these kind of moments that were weird, right? Like maybe this is a Project Blue Book, you know, like maybe this was something that the
part of that
Major Briggs was privy to, some of this knowledge of like this box, you know, like there might be elements like what we experienced in the previous show, because there was a lot of like, you know, abductions happened to Major Briggs, and you know, strange occurrences and phenomena happened. There was a strange phenomena that happened here. So I mean, overall, the stuff that I was connecting with this episode was these strange happenings and this returning to this glass box. It seemed like, because I know, like, from watching The Return, we all have seen it, but elements are kind of blurry because it's been a while since I've seen it. I remember the box coming into play later.
I never completed it.
Okay. The box does come into play later for a significant reason.
Yeah.
And like, I think that's where the return gets, you know, the return happens in the box. I'll say that. Like, a lot of the namesake of this show comes into this box. What that like is, I'm not going to say right now, but from recalling in my mind what pops through this box, not just what we saw in this episode, which was this blurry, jittery, strange thing here. The other entities pop through this box too. But what'd you guys feel about this strange creature?
What did I feel about the creature?
Yeah,
like this, wanted to be this whole best moment. Friend.
Go ahead, Eric. You start us off.
I want to be his best friend. I want to be his best friend. I don't know. It looks like he likes to party, dude.
He is partying hard in that box.
Well, I can tell you what this actually is.
He pops out and eats up or slashes up fucking the little girl from the nanny.
He's like, my boner is so gone.
Whack, dude.
Well, I just remember watching it for the first time, like sitting down and being like, all right, here we go, motherfucker, more Twin Peaks. And this was the episode I got. And if there wasn't, if there was only the scene with Jacoby, or only the scene with Ben and Jerry, or like only a little bit of Hawk and stuff, I would have been sitting there afterwards just being like, man, this is different.
Yeah,
Which it is. It is, but it's like it that would have been digestible, sure, but different enough. You know what I mean? This right. this whole thing is so fucking off the wall with zero context to anything that came before. So you can't really like infer or extrapolate on this and like, oh, well, I mean, it's a fair point to say, like, yeah, maybe this is related to Major Briggs, or maybe this is related to anything that was going on with the Blue Rose Task Force that Gordon Cole was a part of. But just in the thing happening, like, as an isolated event, it's so confusing. And walking away from it, like, we all had the exact same reaction. Right when this episode ended, we were like, all right.
Oh boy.
I guess it's over. And that's the way that it ended was like not only a way to abruptly end that scene, but also just abruptly end the entire fucking episode. It was like, it's just, and that creature? No, thank you. No bueno.
No bueno on that thing.
I'd rather leave it than take it. Thank you very much.
Definitely a strange way to intro like a new entity that's probably not going to be like, I don't recall if it ever comes back again, but I mean, that's a weird thing that pops in.
do you want me to tell you what it actually is supposed to be?
Yeah.
Like, so basically that's Judy.
Oh,
that's Judy coming through, being kind of like inadvertently summoned by a set of circumstances occurring that she basically is like, hey, what's going on here? And then proceeds to just tear these people apart, because that's like just what she does. Just her, she's just, you know, pure chaos, pure, like, you could call it evil, but is the act of something decaying evil? No, not necessarily, but like, she's certainly, like, I don't know if you call her she, but, like, you know, Judy is this, like, negative, malevolent kind of, like, force, et cetera, et cetera. And this is her popping up and saying, hey, not that we're supposed to know that or, like, understand any of that. We're supposed to be confused as fuck right now. But after the fact, I've learned this stuff. And I could tell you who owns the box, like, or what is, you know. And a lot of this stuff is like, I don't know where it would necessarily be like laid out, and they're like, yes, facts, but it's at least what's like commonly understood by most people who watch this show.
Sure. We did
this lady, man. Yeah,
this lady was a very hard pill to swallow. I didn't like her rigmarole she gave these poor cops, like. They just needed entrance to a room.
The whole scene was just her being forgetful and not whatever, them needing a key to get in, and then all of a sudden like, oh my god, key, get in. So it's just like, what were we doing for the last 3.5 minutes?
It, why do you bring on me like this wild goose chase, talking to these other people thinking that, you know, they're in trouble, and it's like, oh, I got a key because I have to feed her plants or whatever the hell.
There's...
Yeah.
To me, she really speaks to, like, that scene that you talked, that you mentioned, I think, last time that we recorded, Tyler, where, like, it's Bobby, and he's standing outside somewhere, and this lady just, like, pulls up in her car, and it's her and her kid, and the lady's just screaming, and her kid, like, just throws up in the car. And the scene goes on for, like, between 3 to 5 minutes, long enough for you to be like, what the fuck is happening? And that lady at the apartment building kind of speaks to, like, whatever you want to call that. She is like the first example of that in this in The Return to Me, because there's those moments where she like stops mid-sentence or catches herself or like this, or she has a reaction that doesn't seem like it would be a typical human reaction.
<It's> or like off kilter, or just, you know, a little bit off.
There's plenty of people that we met in like regular Twin Peaks who are like a little bit off, or maybe like unique or strange in a certain way. But she's just like strange in a way where it's like signaling, like, okay, what's going on? Like, there's something somewhere that is like, is she this way because fucking, I don't even know. Like, so she suffered some sort of trauma and now she's like left as this, the kind of like forgetful mess of a person, or is Buckhorn, South Dakota, another place that like there's maybe some shit in the hills outside of Buckhorn that is causing the people around there to be all crazy and fucky and like, I don't.
Good point. There could be another source, like in North Dakota from the Return, or I mean the Fire Walk With Me, like,
yeah,
very strange things like that trailer park where our guy goes missing, you know, like he just disappears.
Why were there like hookers in a bus full of crying children? Like, it just, this is like, she's so specifically weird, and it's like Twin Peaks The Return weird. It is a specific like brand, like a fucking celebrity goddamn perfume.
Well, there's
strange there's Twin Peaks The Return.
Yeah, there's truth in that, talking about how it could be this isolated apartment complex that has all these strange occurrences happening, and maybe it's affecting their mental state, like this lady being forgetful about things.
What was the thing that they said? What was the thing, the strange thing that, oh fuck, somebody mentioned something where they were like, oh, she gives her, there was just like a couple inferences in there where somebody said something about like, oh, did you hear about Bill? Or like, and this shit, who the fuck is on the other end of the phone? And there's just like, it almost feels like Buckhorn is like the new Twin Peaks, like the new location of the show. And these are characters that maybe we'll get to know. We'll see this motherfucker roll back up in the next episode, and we'll be like, oh, this is, who is that guy? Oh, he's the maintenance guy for the apartment building. Or these police officers are going to be recurring, or like, it just feels like we're taking another peek into this tiny little corner of the world that has its own eccentricities and like weird aspects to it that are like all on different settings than Twin Peaks, but still like the combination of settings still makes it odd and strange.
Yep. It's like pretty barren here. Not a lot of trees.
Yeah, they don't have forests. They just have the hills. But you could do stories about like, you know, oil. You can do stories about the railroad and people maybe excavations and mining.
That's true, because we do talk, and I was going to get to this, Buckhorn could have some semblance of maybe a connection with Native American tribes and things like mm-hmm. that, because we go towards the end here and we have Hawk talking to Log Lady about how Hawk needs to get in touch with his heritage, or whatever she says, or
the thing that is lost.
Yeah,
the thing that is lost is like, has to do with his heritage.
Yep. So there's, again, going back to the elements of Twin Peaks, where it has this history of Native Americans living within the wood, spirits living within nature itself. So there could be a connection in Buckhorn of like, maybe a lot of Native Americans are buried in the hills or something like that. You know, it sounds mm-hmm. like the Battle of Buckhorn, like that could be an existing thing in Twin Peaks lore. Like mm-hmm. back in the day, Buckhorn was this huge massacre of these Native
Americans. There's like a painting. Yeah, it's like in the original series, there's like a painting in the Briggs household. Robert, did I ever tell you about the Battle of Buckhorn?
Exactly. Yeah, it doesn't seem like that could be a thing that, you know, maybe Major Briggs was doing research on. It was like where we have these places where there is tragedy that happened to Native culture, and then through time, just like, you know, in the film Poltergeist, where like, you built this on top of Native like burial grounds, like you have these horrible things happen that cultivates this Black Lodge spirit and entities to kind of like coalesce within those little pockets in those places because of the pain and sorrow that those sites have seen, right?
Yeah.
It kind of makes sense.
Okay. Yeah.
So we're talking about Hawk's like heritage, and he goes into, you know, we got to go through these boxes, Andy. I'll bring the donuts and coffee tomorrow, but I'm going to make sure you got everything. I'm going to lay all this out. There's something missing in here. He's got to find out what it is. And this is where I look, after watching The Return, I had a new appreciation for Hawk's character because of this, because he brings people through like his thought process and his, like, because he's trying to find Dale Cooper. Like, he even brings the other Truman up to speed on like what Margaret said to him and what he needs to do now, and he kind of brings them into the forest. I remember the episode, I don't remember if it's the next one or one after that, where Hawk kind of brings everybody into the forest to kind of get in touch with nature again, and, you know, maybe talk a little bit more about his heritage and things like that. But yeah, overall, it was a confusing episode as a starting episode, but there are things that we can always extrapolate on, and going forward, you know, seeing Cooper at the beginning, it was nice.
That was one thing I wanted to call out, was that, like, to me, if there was any sort of confusion about, like, oh, was that Coop, was that not Coop, etc., I feel like that was, like, we're seeing, you know, special agent Dale Cooper, etc., etc., not some like representation of him or Tulpa or anything like that, because he speaks forward and normally.
Yeah.
It almost seemed like a little bit of the footage that they were using, like, it looked like maybe he was blinking backwards, so I don't know if but regardless,
I still think this is him stuck in the Black Lodge from the end of the second season. That's my thing.
This place specifically is, like, I forget what they call it, but it is specifically a different location than the Black Lodge, but he's not on, like, our plane. He's just like adrift, you know.
Yeah,
like he maybe never came out of that entrance that he went in, but it's like he's just on the other side, and it's like he's just fucking floating around to all kinds of places now.
Yeah, that's right. I'll say that. I'll rephrase or re-put that into Twin Peaks sensibilities. It's like he's not on our plane of existence. He is still stuck within some kind of void away from, you know, him being normal. And the people that are portraying themselves as him are like Mr. C, what I think was his doppelganger from the second season that took up his persona.
That Mr. C was the one who came out and not actually Dale. Yeah.
Yep. And he just decided to be a badass, I guess. Join a biker gang.
Well, from what we see later on, and it's, I guess, like, kind of easily inferred, maybe, from just seeing season 1 and 2. Because look at him right now. Like, visually, he looks like somebody else that we're already familiar with.
Yeah, he looks like Frank. I mean, Bob. Sorry.
Bob. Yeah. Well, not wrong with Frank.
Yeah, Frank Sylvia, or whatever his name is.
And then later on in the show, we get like more connections there. So it's like it's a very clear carrying on and connecting of threads in that way, where it's like, hey, motherfucker, Black Lodge. Like, they're definitely communicating everything well, but it also speaks, I think, specifically to, like, Mr. C being like 50% this, 50% that, or some combination of, like, Dale, this thing, that thing,
then spit back out into the world.
Well, here's what I think. Like
they scraped a sample off of Dale, made their own little doppelganger, and then put the fuel in it and put it out in the world.
Here's what, when we talked about that last episode of the second season, where we talked about, you know, having a complete pure white soul gives you permission to go to the White Lodge, right? Because we know Major Briggs has made that trip, and he's always had that, you know, no fear no fear shirt on whenever he goes to the White Lodge. So what I think is, maybe there could be some truth to this, maybe I'm just speculating, maybe it's just a cool, interesting idea, that mm-hmm. when Cooper went to the waiting room of the lodge, his soul like split when he was faced with those kind of moments in his life where he was scared and he, you know, became fearful. His id and ego or whatever, like the sides of his brain that made him fearful and more pure of heart, maybe split, and that personality became Mr. C when the doppelganger left, and there's part of him that was pure that is Dougie.
Sure.
And because you look at Dougie, he's wearing vivid clothes, he's very pure, simple minded, and like
Dougie's wearing, the first time that we see Dougie, he is wearing the colors of the font that is used, like that we saw in the beginning of this episode, where it was like Twin Peaks, because it's a very specific color of green and brown.
Yeah.
So, and those are the colors that Dougie is wearing when we see him first.
That's where I'm thinking is, like, because before this, like, oh yeah, okay, Dale's doppelganger, the one with like the white eyes that's like screaming with Bob.
White eyes.
And then, you know, we get to the return and we see this Dougie Jones character that's just saying his name, and you know, it's like, well, he had a whole life where he was a father.
Yeah.
And he's a husband, and he's, to me, that reminds me, he has a wife and he has a child who is a son, and then so did Major Briggs. Major Briggs was a father and a husband, and he loved his wife. He would always, you know, the wife always knew that he would come back after these weird things that would happen, and she never would really question it. So there's connections there with, like, Dougie being able to go to the White Lodge.
But do we... And this is... Are we to assume that Dougie always looked like Dale? Or, like, you know what I mean? Like, before any of this happened, was... Because, Dougie has a wife, he has a child, he has a life separate and previous to, like, all this stuff going on.
And
so
he's gotten by being very simple-minded. Like, he's, you know...
But people know him. Clearly, he's been able to, like... he's been able to communicate and, like, live his life to at least some normal degree where people know him as being this person and not just, oh, Dougie, he's the guy who can only say his name.
You're right.
But when we join Dougie and we see everything go down, obviously it's different, but like,
we know,
did
that
he always
no, he probably didn't, and here's where I think the Dale Cooper side of him is trying to merge back with his id or his other ego. Like, he's trying, like, the Dale that's stuck in the realms beyond makes its way back through the electricity into Dougie, and that kind of maybe fucked with his brain a little bit, so he's still, like, kind of trying to burst through. That's why, like, when I watched, you know, Dougie take that first sip of coffee, I'm like, oh, he's gonna remember, right? But he's not fully formed yet, so he's not completely Dale Cooper.
So, well, what I mean is, his wife Janie E, when Dale goes through what he goes through and Dougie gets, like, swapped, you know, where, yeah, it's no longer the person of Dougie Jones, it's the Dougie Jones that is, like, the chrysalis of fucking Dale.
Yeah, yeah.
When that happens and he, like, shows back up at home and she puts her eyes on him, does he all of a sudden look like Dale or Kyle MacLachlan, and in her mind is just, like, her memories kind of get, like, rewritten because of all the ooky
supernatural shit, and that's just all he's how he's looked, or that's is it
good
like?
Good point. Am I forgetting that maybe we should see a picture of the real Dougie Jones?
I don't think that we do. I just think that he's always looked like. I think they just share the same, like they're like as if they were twins, you know? That because then I think that's easy for her to not question why. Yes, Dougie may be like acting strange and acting different, but he still looks exactly like the person that she married however long ago.
Okay, I guess, yeah.
And I'm the part of the reason I'm saying that is like nobody ever speaks up and says like, "Holy shit, Dougie, you look like a completely different human being than you did a couple days ago. What the fuck happened?" You know?
Exactly. Yeah, nothing like that I recall happening. I mean,
never.
I just know that. Who knows if Dougie had like this before this had like an infatuation or an obsession with coffee, but I remember him just taking people's coffees out of like the coffee runner that went to go get coffees for the whole firm. He's just like grabbing theirs. And
that is one thing I'm specifically like really excited for is to see more Dougie Joe, like him in the casinos in Vegas.
Yep. Yep. So anything else Mr. to say Jeff about this? I mean, it's a tricky episode to start off with, I would say.
Well, this being the first time watching it since I saw it when it came out, I'm just excited to like revisit it for that reason, to watch it again after 6-ish years.
Yeah, yeah, me too. Like, I only saw it when it was releasing. And it is fun to revisit this, especially after watching Kyle MacLachlan in the Fallout show. I mean, even that's amazing. Like, Kyle MacLachlan is in one of the better adaptations of a video game. Like, man, it's really thundering out there. So I'm glad we watched it tonight. Get a lot of spooky vibes. Bracho, say something about The Return.
It's returned.
Is it returned for you? Are you in the mode of listening to Battle Lamenti and?
Hey, I heard the Battle Lamenti and I was right in the world, dude.
Getting cozy. So yeah, well, this is first of many. Do you guys want to know what this episode's called?
Oh man! All right, I want us. Please don't tell us until we've both given a guess, but I'd like us both to give a shot in the dark here.
Okay, this episode, do you want to know what this first episode was called, or are you going to guess that?
No, we're going to guess that, so okay. We're each going to guess. Eric, what do you think?
32.
Oh! Huh. Okay, going the old numerical route, huh?
Yep. How about you?
God damn, there's so many things. I don't know. Look.
Could be numbers, too. I don't know.
Okay, could be numbers.
It's a line from the episode.
From this episode?
Yeah, it's a line from this episode.
I don't know. Okay, I'm just going to pick a line from the episode. Which one?
Is that the answer? Or is that your guesses? Which one?
Mm-hmm. Because Lucy said that about the sheriff, but it could also be about like which Dale or which one, you know.
If I didn't, my wild guess would be like same birthday as Marlon Brando. No, but it's actually my log has a message for you.
Oh damn.
R.I.P.
Yeah. And the next episode is called The Stars Turn and a Time Presents Itself. I'm liking these longer title. It gives me some kind of like idea of maybe what they're doing and what I should focus on. So yeah, we'll be back with season 3, episode 2 of The Return. The Stars Turn and a Time Presents Itself. So stay tuned. We have 18 of these puppies.
Not enough.
Which I was just gonna say, it's like you saying that, there's two reactions that happen at once in my mind, and it's like it's not enough, and it's also kind of daunting.
Sure. It's like a hill that we're going to climb. You know what I mean? Like,
we're this couple watching the show right now. We're like, that's such
stick a third of us in there. Somebody's the plant. Somebody's the bonsai. But it's like a roller coaster. Like there's gonna be so many peaks and valleys and dips and dives and twists and turns. Look at Andy's face there. He's like, But I genuinely feel like a little bit daunted by the idea of 18 more of these, especially the idea of like fucking episode 8. You remember what episode 8 is?
Kind of. Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, the title kind of gave it away for me, but yeah.
So, yeah. It's just going to be, it's going to be a good time, man.
I'm excited, yeah. So, we'll let Eric go back to his dream soul state, and we'll leave it with this.
Who is question marks in the credits? Is this a sound that we're just letting Eric sleep to?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I see. Yeah.
Oh, it was Judy, right?
No. Carol Strukin is the gentleman playing the giant. He was Lurch. He's the extremely tall man who...
Well, why don't you name him the giant? That's what he was because titled.
But he's not. That's why it's question mark, question mark, question mark. Is this... I believe this is not technically the giant.
Oh, okay.
I don't know, man.
Well, he is dressed as like a different...
Yeah, I forget how he's dressed, but isn't he in like a... Oh, okay, yeah, it's almost like jacket. A smoking jacket, yeah. But it's like a nice suit jacket.
He evolved.
Or changed it, just like the arm did, you know?
True, the arm did evolve.
It very well could be the same entity, just like different or changed. I don't know.
Yeah, man, I'm excited. Well, I'll just outro this here quick. So... let us know if you watched The Return recently. What are your thoughts on it? Hopefully you guys can get a hold of this, watch it somewhere. If you have Showtime, it could be still up there on their streaming platform. Let us know what you think in the comments below, and make sure you hit that like button. Let us know that you like Twin Peaks too as much as we do. And yeah, we'll be back with more. Thanks for joining us.
Leave a comment, please. Start a discussion.
Yeah, discuss this with us.